leads, when the Spirit comes, the power. See how the Lord leads. I feel like tonight will be more combusted. And I tell you what, I haven't got to talk to anyone about this, but I don't know if a keyboard player is available, but if you could get hold of someone, and yeah, just come on up now if you wouldn't mind. And don't play something you know, just play. Okay? Yeah, that's good. I work good with that, okay? In John 12, verses 20 and 21, it's Philip came, and there were certain Greeks who were coming up to worship at the feast. They came to Philip inquiring, "We would see Jesus." In all generation amongst the peoples, this is the ultimate inquiry. We must see Jesus in our daily lives and in our ministries. We must see Jesus. In fact, we must reveal Jesus. In the midst of birthing prayer storm, the Holy Spirit has strictly instructed me that it can't just be about warring, although I believe in warring intercession. It can't just be about crisis intervention. I must help people maintain oil on their machinery lest they burn out. So this was true for us, for me in the whole prayer storm. This is true in my life. It's true for yours. And it's true all the more at the end of the age, and I'm going to show it to you. It's true all the more at the end of the age that we maintain the oil of intimacy, and one of the keys of that is soaking presence worship. See, he's coming. He's coming. He's already here. There's many ways he comes. And there's the power blast. And then there's the soaking grounds where it's just like we're crusty. And he just marinates us. We simmer. You can cook a lot of different ways. I've had to learn a whole lot of new skill sets in these last 3 years. And you can turn that dial up to 10 all the way on the stove, and you're likely to burn. Or you can turn it lower and simmer. It might take a little bit longer for it to reach the boiling point. Catch the fire to be able to maintain it. Come, Holy Spirit. I'm going to ground you in the Word, but if you end up going into an experience, it's fine with me. Because one of the entrances into the trance-ecstatic realm, I don't know if you heard Stacy clearly this morning or not. She talked about closing the door, in a sense. That was the words of Jesus. That we close our door and we come and we meet with him. And she talked about the necessity of quietness. And it's then out of that place deposits come. Deposits come. You see, you minister out of giftedness to others, but you've got to do more than just have a relationship with God through gifts. In fact, that's not the fullness. You got to have a relationship for yourself. Interpretation of things you've gone through, you'll see things through a different lens. to see him through his. You'll begin to become aware that everything does matter, that he hasn't forgotten you. And if all you do is you sit with him for a while and you didn't hear anything, didn't see anything, it's all okay, because your purpose in that setting was not primarily information. Your purpose in that setting is being a son and a daughter, no matter what your age is. And God's an equal opportunity. He has an equal opportunity lap. You can come sit in his lap at any time. Remember, one of the things in growing up, sitting on my grandpa's lap, and what would he do? He pulled out his pocket watch and he listened to the ticking of the watch. I remember my dad with my kids and his Oshkosh overalls, pull out his pocket watch and set Justin, my miracle boy, on his lap, and he'd pull out his pocket watch. Why do we do things like that? I don't know. But they're endearing. And right now, Daddy, maybe it's more like he's almost like your grandpa right now. Grandpa God is inviting you to come sit in his lap. And he has a tiny piece he's pulling out. And he just wants you to listen. And he wants your heart to get in rhythm with his. And he just wants you to listen. And he wants you to lean in. He wants you to listen. Some of you have heard me probably teach this kind of thing before, and it's okay, because we just get to lean in. Jesus in Matthew 11:28 said it like this: "Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you shall find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my load is light." The key to life is coming to Jesus. We come to him, we receive rest for our souls. A divine exchange transpires as he takes our heavy load and gives us his grace. This is true and well in the ministry of intercession. We must come first to him. We need to cover our devotional needs first, and then we have the grace as an empowered life to accomplish his missions. And we both win when we keep first things first. In Matthew 24:25, Jesus' primary teaching on the end time, just before going to the cross. Matthew 24:29-31, it reads, "Immediately after the tribulation in those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. Then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds. He will send his angels with, and they will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other." And in verse 37-41, Jesus prophesied of the great death toll that will occur in the generation that he returns. "As in the days of Noah, so also will be the Son of Man will be. For in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking. Until the day that Noah entered the ark, they did not know until the flood came, took them away. So will be at the coming of the Son of Man be. Then two men will be in the field, one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be grinding at the mill, one will be taken, the other will be left. Two men will be in the field, one will be taken, the other left." They said, "Where, Lord?" Luke 17:36-37. "Where the body is, there the eagles will be gathered." In Matthew 24:25, there's a connection between, in Matthew 13:32-37. "Watch therefore, for you do not know the hour that the Lord is coming. But know this, that if the master of the house had known what hour the thief would come, he would have watched and not allowed his house, the place of inheritance, to be broken into." Matthew 24. Years ago, and I compared three gospel accounts of these same set of scriptures here. And I found that the most often, you know, there's a lot of teaching about what will happen in the end times, but there's been very little teaching comparatively of how to respond in the last days, in the end times. And what I found is that the word watch is the one that is used the most often in the three gospel accounts of Jesus' teaching, where he tells us how to act and how to respond. The primary thing he told us was three times more than anything else was watch. One of the other things that primarily he told us was fear not, don't be afraid. But three times more than anything else, he said, watch. Why is that? I grew up stumbling into these truths. There actually is one of the pockets of church history that's not that far away from here in Zion, Illinois. Not just Alexander Dowie's, but there's another pocket of a Pentecostal expression called the Zion Faith Homes. They were led by a woman named Martha Wing Robinson. Her biography was called Radiant Glory. They're only one of the peoples who were stewards of some of these truths. They're called waiting on God, is one way of describing it. Jesus said that he didn't do anything unless he first saw. So if you're going to see, you got to watch. Jesus didn't do anything unless he first saw the Father doing it. And then he went out. He stepped out. So I went through a period of time where I couldn't sleep at night. Some thought I had sleep apnea or sleep deprivation or whatever it was, or it was some whatever, you know. That wasn't what it was at all. It was God. He wanted to have an appointment with me. And I would wake up night after night after night after night at 2 a.m. in the morning. And I would lay there in my bed, struggle, not get up, and then have a fitful sleep the rest of the night and wake up on the grumpy side. And then when I finally understood and yielded to what it was that the Father was doing, I entered into a whole new depth in my life with God, and then my life before man. And I started simply getting up when he woke me up, and for about every other night for about 15 years, I would get up at 2 a.m. in the middle of the night like a nursing mother with a child feeding. And I would get up and just go sit in the living room in my chair. And I would be there for an hour to 2 hours. Most of the time it was not intense birthing intercession. I believe in that and I walk in that. Most of the time it wasn't this heavy burden of the Lord that came upon me. I know that and I walk in that. And I try to release that. That wasn't what this was about at all. This was simply communion with God. And I would just sit there with him for a while. This was long before the terminology soaking worship got coined. It's been one of the benefits of this last 15 years of the river or so, 17 years, is that one of the things that's actually been used to restore is this whole realm of waiting on the Lord, or the common term today is soaking. Soaking. I'm not going to take us through all of the Matthew 24 passage, but I am going to have us just look very quickly at a little more of this. Bridal intimacy at the end of the age, Matthew 25, 1-4. Then the kingdom of heaven shall be likened to 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were wise and 5 were foolish. Those who were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. 10 virgins, they're all born again believers. 2 Corinthians 11:2 says, I betrothed you to one husband, that I may present you as a virgin to Christ. Each one had a measure of a revelation to the bridegroom. And they carried a lamp, a ministry. 5 were wise and prepared. 5 were foolish. And they were not prepared for the days that were upcoming. They each had lamps or ministries that brought light to others. You compare a lot of scriptures, Matthew 5:15, Revelation 1:20, Zechariah 4:2, Isaiah 62:1, and others. And John 5:35 for details. They all went out to encounter Jesus, the bridegroom. And one of the primary ways the Lord expresses himself in the end times is through the revelation of the bridegroom king. But the oil speaks of the relationship with the Holy Spirit. The result is that our hearts are tenderized, sensitized, to feel more of God's love for us. This increases our spiritual capacity for Jesus and our revelation of him as it empowers us with zeal for righteousness. In fact, where it's talking about the foolish and the wise, that is not saying one category was saved and the other category wasn't. It's in other scriptures that then the unsaved are given the references that they were wicked, lazy, fearful, and cursed ones. That's Matthew 25. So I don't want you to think that these 10 virgins, they all had lamps. But some had oil and were prepared for the day. And some, even with lamps of ministry, are not prepared for the day. Hey, have you ever gotten the cart ahead of the horse? Have you ever started in the Spirit, like the book of Galatians talks about, and it says, oh, you foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? That you started in the Spirit, you think you can perfect yourself by returning back to the power of the soul. Well, there's a tendency in all of our lives to do this. Can we be honest? And if you take a nap and go into a dream right now, I really don't care. Okay? It's a little hot, and this is a slow message. Okay? Because you're going to simmer. And so this wise and foolish is not an issue of saved and unsaved, because they all have a relationship. But it's whether there's oil in your lamp to keep you prepared and ready for the days. And it deals with the relationship of the Holy Spirit. At the midnight hour of history, the Spirit will raise up forerunners who cry out that Jesus is coming. Now we must go out to meet him. While the bridegroom was delayed, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight, the cry was heard, behold, the bridegroom is coming. Go out to meet him. Let me play with your theology for a moment. The word here, the bridegroom is coming, we must go out to meet him. It's an ongoing active tense verb. So it's the bridegroom has come, he is coming, and he will come. It's all of it. It's present active tense. So Jesus has already come. We know that Jesus is coming, as we call it, the doctrine of the second coming. But what I want to work with you just for a little bit, hang with me, is he wants to come to us now, personally. So in that sense, don't strain on this too hard. I'm talking about the three comings of Jesus. The first coming, where the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The second being where he comes to us. He comes to us. He keeps coming to us. Before three, he comes for us. How else is the bride going to be without spot or wrinkle or any such thing? It's because he keeps coming with waves of his presence to us. And those are the wise ones who receive the waves of his coming. there's gentle waves and there's power. It's just about, and then it backs off. And then you wonder if it made any difference. Well, I'm a man, I've never had them. But I was with my wife 4 times. And all I want to just simply say is, it all counts. He's coming. He's coming. He's already here. And so between the first and that second great coming where he splits the eastern sky, he comes. He comes. He comes. And he comes. And he keeps coming. And that's what revival is. Revival is lessons of when he comes. And it's lessons on whether a people in a city, a state, a nation, a denomination receive his coming or not. Behold, here comes the Lord. Let us go out and meet him. You have to do something. I couldn't just stay in my bed. I had to get up. And when I would get up and go sit in my chair, I met with him. You have your own stories. And I would meet with him night after night after night after night after night after night. And I felt like I was a nursing mother with a child. And being deposited within the womb of my spirit were purposes of God. And I started walking in what's called the watch of the Lord before it was even being taught. Before IHOP used the word, before Mahesh and Bonnie Shah to have the watch of the Lord, I was up in the middle of the night watching. I was watching and waiting, watching and waiting, watching and waiting. My heart was getting tenderized. He's coming. He's coming. He's already here. And he can come to you and your house. You know that. One of the glorious things to do is to have soaking worship parties. And if you need, just get a Kimberly and Alberto Rivera CD and you're in the church that I attend and just put them on. And dude, if you can't have a trance with that, you are dead.
I got it.
John Bell is one of the leading soaking worship instrumentalists today. He was my personal ministry assistant. I helped mentor him in these ways. How could I mentor someone when I don't even play an instrument? Because I've spent time with Jesus. And I do play an instrument. No, he plays one. My heart. And he comes like a great orchestra conductor. And he plucks the strings of my heart. He's coming. He's coming. He's already here.
He's coming. He's coming.
He's coming here.
Sit with me for a while.